lightning, there's a myth that lightning does not strike twice in the same place. But for this unfortunate person who gets cup, it strikes twice. The first time when he's told, oh God, you've got a cancer. And that too, you have a metastatic cancer. That's the first hit. And then after a round of so many tests, investigations, radiology, pathology, then we tell him, "Arey, we don't know what's the primary." That's the second time he gets a big shock, which is really quite a disillusioning shock for him. He feels that the doctors have not done their job properly. So what is this cancer of unknown primary or CUP? It's a sort of a heterogeneous group of cancers. And since I'm talking to oral pathologists, I have tried to concentrate more on head and neck rather than the other sites. But it becomes our job to identify what could be the possible primary. What is the tumor type of grade? How far has it extended? And more important, it's health. We are supposed to try and discover if this tumor could possibly be treated and if this patient will benefit from this. Because we must realize that these cancers are killers. The vast majority of them will have a very aggressive, rapid course, and they're usually fatal between a year and a half after detection. So my roadmap is very simple. I'm going to give a few introductory remarks. I will be emphasizing on head and neck lesions. I'll touch a little bit on FNAC, the biopsy, and a lot on the IHC. I'll deal with some common histological types, favorable and unfavorable, go through some of the mistakes or the mimics we've seen, some of the poorly differentiated and undifferentiated tumors. I'll wind up with the strengths and weaknesses of IHC, because IHC is the corner of CUP. Without IHC, we won't be able to go far. And then what is the changing scenario? And then I'll wind up. So CUP is not important because it's so rare. It's more important because it's the fourth commonest cause of death, cancer death. And it's an aggressive disease, quickly takes the patient down a bad road. It is unpredictable. And in 70% of the cases, it is lethal. We do have subsets which are favorable and unfavorable. Whatever is the type of cancer, all these patients do require treatment, including the asymptomatic patients. So what's so different about erratic metastatic patterns? What's so different? You have metastatic cancers. The difference is that there is a different type of pattern. For example, lung cancers, when they present as CUPs, they involve the bone only in 4%. Whereas when they are in the other mode, they're 30 to 50% involved. Can I reduce this? Yeah. All right. Pancreatic cancers presenting as CUP are fourfold more, they have a higher incidence in bones, and 30% incidence appears with lung mets. Prostate cancers also, the in CUP mode, they have threefold less incidence in bones. For head and neck, it's a slightly better scene. HPV-related head and neck cancers have an advantage over non-HPV-related in general. And this also holds true for the CUP cases. Okay, so we always have some doubting Thomases in life. So there's a good paper I read, a recent paper, which actually asks the question, does CUP exist really? Or are we doing a bad job? Is the pathologist and the radiologist not doing a good enough job? So do you have errors because of incomplete or inadequate diagnostics? Are we misinterpreting pathology, radiology, and IHC? Are we not classifying them properly? Is the MET really a new primary or what is it? Mistaking a relapse of an antecedent malignancy as CUP? I'll come to this in a little more detail. But there is CUP. What supports the concept of CUP? CUP cases are aggressive. They have atypical metastatic patterns, as I showed you. They have a very rapid course. Usually they have a poor response to chemotherapy and there's a dismal output. If autopsy studies are to be believed, then though we do find the primary in some percentage of cases, in some you never find the primary. And gene profiling patterns of these cancers are a little different from those where a primary has been detected. So CUP does exist. So for the benefit of this, what is the clinical course? Let's say a patient presents with a mass. Usually in 94% of patients, it is painless. He hardly has weight loss or pain in the early stages. But after he has detected the mass, he goes through a round of tests, let's say radiology, pathology, that takes about 2 to 5 months. And then the course becomes dismal. If you have got a favorable CUP, he's lucky. If it's non-favorable, he usually has, it's usually followed by death within a year. So all patients should receive treatment because the disease is aggressive, it rapidly grows and is often fatal. Now I like to begin with this FNSE because I also trained in FNSE in my very early days. Can FNSE work for CUP cases? Yes, of course. Most Indian pathologists, we've had to learn to interpret FNSEs because it is so cost effective. It is sensitive, specific. It's much cheaper for the patients. If it's a deep-seated lesion, FNSE can comb down to that lesion. It can be repeated with multiple passes. And all you need is really a good PAP. In our hospital, we do one PAP, one HNE, and one GIMSA for all cases of FNSE. IHC can also be performed if you plan it well, especially if it's a deep-seated lesion. So the accuracy is quite high. Specificity and sensitivity is good. What are the clinical symptoms that dictate where to search? Let's take nodes. Majority of the patients present, 42% or so present with different nodes. If it's an axillary, there is no problem. Usually it's a breast, neck nodes, aeropharyngeal digestive tract, retroperitoneal nodes. It could be any of the ovary, testes, germ cell tumors, and so down the list. Fluids are also very ominous. Sometimes you get a patient with 10 societies and you just don't know where the primary is, though you detect metastatic cells in the fluid. Bones are another tragic area. Even though we know that many of these cancers could be favorable, in my experience, bone metastasis usually has a very unfavorable prognosis. So what are the tools that we can use? There's a whole heap of tools. For pathology, we have good histopath. There is no shortcut to a good histopath. IHC, you can do molecular, but I have no experience here. In the good old days, we would even do EM if we suspected something like a mesothelioma. Different modalities for imaging and the scopes which go through a lot of orifices. So even after using all the tools available, you do an extensive and really good workup. The antemortem frequency of actually finding the primary is not high. It's 30%, and today it's around 58% in some centers, but the usual average is low. That's why this has been called an orphan cancer. So what really happened to the primary? Where did it just go? The primary probably didn't go through the stage of, say, DCIS or in situ. It just landed up as a metastatic lesion. It is believed that some of them spontaneously regressed. They might have been very small and they've regressed. Immunity of the body may have destroyed it. The rate of growth may be faster for the metastatic lesion than for the primary, and the primary has sloughed off and died off, or it's so slow and so small that it's in a hidden place. Postmortems, when they were done, now postmortems are very few in the field, but when postmortems were done, there was a good paper, a good PPT by Nicholas Pavlidis, where a large number of autopsies were done, and the two common sites of finding the primary were the lung and the pancreas, and smaller in different areas. Okay, now this question is important. Why bother to categorize? We know it's an aggressive disease. Yes, true. And the unfavorable and the poor prognostics are in the large majority, they're 80%. But there are patients who do well. And this 20% are the treatable cancers. Most often they are the ones where hormones can be manipulated. Therefore, they are the primaries from breast, prostate, ovary, thyroid, germ cell tumors, and when there's a single site involvement. The unfavorable ones obviously will be those from the retroperitoneum when multiple nodes are involved, when the GI tract or the lungs are the primary, and usually when the rapid turnover is taking place. So the list of the favorable good prognostic types are these germ cell tumors, especially in males. In fact, they largely occur in males. Extragonadal germ cell tumors, which give a very good prognosis. Women with papillary adenocarcinoma of the peritoneal cavity. Women with adenocarcinoma involving only the axillary nodes. Squamous carcinoma involving a single or few cervical nodes. Some well-differentiated, what we used to say, carcinoid tumors. Men with blastic bone mets and elevated PSA, when a prostate is the occult primary, and when they are isolated lymph nodes. The unfavorable are all the rest. When you have multiple organs involving the lung, liver, non-papillary malignant ascites, brain mets, so on and so forth. These are really the unfortunate patients. Now let's go to histology, which is our territory. The majority of CUP cases are adenocarcinomas, making up more than half. The next are the poorly differentiated carcinomas, which make out about 30%. Squamous carcinomas make up 80%, and then the rest, like neuroendocrine tumors, etc. Head and neck, okay, because head and neck is the area which oral pathologists are interested. 8% of lesions in the head and neck are CUP lesions, so they are unknown primaries. In these unknown primaries, the vast majority are the simple, common squamous carcinomas. We must remember that a primary in the head and neck can also mimic a metastatic lesion. The area is limited, and sometimes you mimic a primary for a mets and vice versa. You go and ask the patient, did you have a cancer in the past? And what could be the answers? Yes, if he says, yes, I did have, maybe now what you're seeing is a mets. Maybe it's a second primary. Maybe it's a treatment-associated cancer. Or it's a treatment-associated change which is mimicking a cancer. So this history is important and this workup is important. There is a variability, for example, nasopharyngeal cancers in our country are so often seen in north, in the northeast. And so if you look at the American papers, they have a different percentage of involvement as compared to different countries. So now what has the AJCC got to say? Since 2017, the AJCC workup is that we must do HPV or EBV whenever possible. The common cancer squamous carcinoma, patients are middle-aged to elderly, most often males. It's the level 2 which is the dangerous, and they come with a bunch of nodes involved. The level of the involved nodes offers some insight to us. What should we look for? If it is a unilateral node involvement, it's far more common. But we do have instances, for example, base of tongue or lesions in the larynx, where 10% of these patients present with bilateral nodes. How many nodes are we looking at? In the head and neck, as many as 300 nodes can be dissected out. The ones we deal with are the ones above and below the sternocleidomastoid. And this is a good chart to tell you that if you find a node, for example, in 1A, look around in the oral cavity, in the lip, in the submaxillary gland. Level 2, or the 2A and B, the oral cavity, nasopharynx, so on and so forth. For example, thyroid. I will show you as I go along. A high node mets from a thyroid is very unlikely. It's likely to be here or level 2 or level 3. And it's unlikely to be supraclavicular. So this, your own experience will tell you where to look. What are the patterns or the morphological cell types? Carcinomas can look very, very bizarre. They can look like the conventional big polygonal cells, abundant, eosinophilic. They can look glandular, spindly. They can mimic small round cell tumors, like small cell carcinomas also. And you can have anaplastic ones with bizarre and giant cells. The common cancer of the common man in our lab, the commonest ones we see are keratinizing and non-keratinizing squamous carcinomas. Now, in literature, they have even described verrucous carcinomas as cup, but I have never seen a verrucous carcinoma presenting as a cup. Undifferentiated carcinoma, quite common. And then the mimics, the sarcomatoid, spindly types, the undifferentiated types. In addition, you will have basaloid types, nasopharyngeal, nut cancers, and some of these carcinomas, squamous carcinomas, are so undifferentiated that they can mimic non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, melanomas, or high-grade neuroendocrine tumors and sarcomas. This paper is a good paper of a review of head and neck carcinoma of unknown primary. This paper tells us two important things. If you have HPV, 80% of them have come from the oropharynx. And if you're looking at non-keratinizing forms with EBV positivity, you're looking at a nasopharyngeal cancer. So the message is just this: HPV, oropharynx; EBV, look for nasopharynx. So you have these two viruses in the same paper, what I have told you. P16 is a good IHC marker, which we can do to establish that is of HPV origin. These patients do better than those who are non-HPV. And the opposite is EBV is best screened with ISH. We don't do this very often because it's expensive, and most of our patients come from the lower socioeconomic strata. So this is a decision tree given by this paper. Cervical metastasis of squamous carcinoma, do a P16. If P16 is positive, usually in the non-keratinizing, it is HPV. P16 negative, non-keratinized, it is negative for HPV. For this other category of keratinizing, you may have to do higher molecular tests. So the two big giants in the head and neck are, in our experience, the keratinizing and the non-keratinizing squamous carcinoma. We do start with FNAC, and if we need to do IHC, then we ask for a needle core biopsy, or sometimes they send us the material of the whole node. So you have keratinizing, non-keratinizing squamous carcinoma. Here is a case of a 34-year-old tobacco chewer. No primary was found, but he had a level 2 and level 3 neck enlargement for 2 months. Spindly looking cells, but nice pattern of carcinoma in a lymph node. P16 positivity, block positivity, telling you that it is probably an HPV related cancer of the oropharynx. Let's look at some FNACs we've seen. Sometimes you get cells which are slightly ovoid or spindly, even pleomorphic in appearance. You have to start thinking, am I looking at a sarcomatoid squamous carcinoma? Am I looking at a neuroendocrine tumor? Or is it something totally different? This case came out to be a non-keratinizing and a bit of a sarcomatoid squamous carcinoma, which can look pretty deceptive. If you are in doubt, is it a melanoma? Is it a neuroendocrine? You can establish your diagnosis with a simple CK EMA, rule out melanomas or neuroendocrine. And again, if P16 is positive, you know it's an HPV-related CUP case. This is another tumor we saw in the FNSC. Highly undifferentiated, large cells. Sometimes you've got to be diligent. You've got to look around. And one stray cell or few stray cells will give you the clue that you're dealing with a squamous carcinoma. Necrotizing squamous carcinomas, another difficult area if you've got mainly necrotic and high-grade areas. Again, it's IHC, P16 or EBA, which will come to your rescue. So what is the basic IHC panel? If you are in doubt about carcinoma, we do a simple CK EMA. And I like to do a Ki-67 because I have made mistakes in the past. P40, P16, P63, these are the specialized ones. When you've established it's a carcinoma and you're trying to figure out whether it's HPV related of the oropharynx or of the nasopharynx. If you feel you are not dealing with a squamous carcinoma but an adeno, you may need to resort to CK7, CK20. Decide your panel, initial panel first, and then according to the results, look for IHC of specific organ. This I learned from Dr. Vikas Kavikar. So you have these initial panel, necrotizing squamous carcinoma, deceptive one, because it can mimic or it can be mimicked by benign lesions like suppurative pathology, a Worthen's tumor, and in fact, infected branchial cyst, metaplasia, or even an ameloblastoma. If you've got only necrotic material in your first needle push, it's a good idea to aspirate from the periphery and do it again till you get material. This case is from a lady from Assam, a metastatic level 2 node, big cells, prominent ovular nuclei, cell cytoplasmic borders, not so clear. This is what we had learned in the good old days as a lymphoepithelioma of nasopharyngeal type. I'll skip this. Some of the lessons we have learned, some of them by burning our hands, I'm giving you a few examples of where things can go wrong. Everything is not always hunky-dory. Considerable overlap exists between benign and malignant lesions. Nature has great mimics, and I think they have a good laugh at us quite often. I'll begin with this story, which starts in the frozen section. It's a common story. A young man of 23 came with a large firm neck mass. It came to us with a diagnosis of metastatic squamous carcinoma. Clinically, it was a CUP case. We got this in the frozen section room. Excision was performed. Now I'm showing you all this, even though the chronology is different. The neck showed a huge cystic mass, huge. And what we got out of the stuff was white turbid material. This was the cyst which was collapsed, and this was the wall of the cyst. The material was turbid, and the cells which came out, and this, remember, is all in the frozen room. We got cells like this. Bad looking squamoid cells. But if you look very closely, their nuclei are not so overtly malignant looking. They are big polygonal cells, but then we've seen well-differentiated tumors with this type of morphology. So on cytology, before we gave the diagnosis, we were wondering, what are we looking at? Is this a MET or is this something like a branchial cyst? And you can really slip over here. Look closely at the cells. Nuclei are bland, even though they are enlarged. They have nuclei. They look a little angry, like reactive cells. Outside report, of course, from a good institute was metastatic squamous carcinoma. But I believe they probably did not know the ultrasound findings. When we did a frozen of the wall, we found a lining of squamous, very well demarcated, discrete, and below it, a huge mass of lymphoid tissue. So it was a cyst with stratified squamous epithelium, underlying lymphoid tissue. This was a branchial cyst mimicking as a squamous carcinoma. So a benign lesion, but we could have gone wrong if we had not known the ultrasound findings and if frozen had not been done properly at that time. Other mimics, they are common errors. If you mistake yours, if you think your CK or your immuno is the ultimate answer, you're going to be in trouble. You have to use a panel of tests. You could mistake a carcinoma for NHL and vice versa. Some epithelioid sarcomas for carcinoma. And never forget that melanomas are great mimics. I'll show you a few more cases. To avoid a diagnosis or misdiagnosis of squamous carcinoma, whenever something looks too good to be true, take a detailed history. Remember your triple test. You need clinical, you need histology and radiology. It's only when they all fit that you can be very confident that your report is correct. Now, here is a case of great mimicry. This happened many years ago, but I still cringe when I think about it. This was a 49-year-old male who came with a level 2 mass. Now, this slide is not mine because my slides are God knows where, but I took this from the net. This looks for all the world like a thyroid cancer. It had these big spaces with colloid-like material and bleb. And we thought we were dealing with a thyroid cancer in the frozen section room. The surgeons impetuously did a thyroidectomy and no thyroid tumor was found. So they said, what? Is this a cup from the thyroid? Is there a scar? Is there something which has gone away? On taking a very detailed past history, we found the patient had been operated for a parotid tumor 4 years ago. This was not a cup. So that paper which says that it does cup exist, this fellow must have encountered instances where something was called cup but was not really a cup. This turned out eventually to be metastatic, a follicular variant of an acinic cell carcinoma. These things are treacherous. They look so much like thyroid. And since then, we had 4 more cases which look like this, follicular and papillary variants of acinic cell carcinoma, great mimics of thyroid cancers. There's another case which started off, we got it in the frozen again. This cytology looked like some adenoid cystic structure. No primary was found anywhere. And then when we went ahead, when we got the specimen, we realized that the primary was in the minor salivary glands around the larynx. It was not in any of the major ones. This again was not a cup. It was just the tumor spread from a small primary in the larynx. Another case, mucin looking, large cells, prominent nuclei, looking glandular. Look at the polymorphs sticking to it. The polymorphs are probably attracted because they are secreting mucin. This was a young man with 10 cystites. We could pin it down to a GI tract, though we didn't find it due to his 10 cystites. Finding an adenocarcinoma in a head and neck or in a bone. This is something which I have found is very difficult to handle. Metastatic adeno in level 1, 2, 3. If they are high up in the neck, then we need to think of salivary or thyroid. If it's a lower neck, like a supraclavicular node, you could or you should think of something like a breast, lung, kidney, testicle, or uterus, which is shooting off its mets into the neck. You need to do a panel of IHCs for this. Now, I'll tell you a tragic story of a very young, strapping man. A man who was in the military forces. He was referred to Tara Hospital with a diagnosis of metastatic adeno, the beautiful adenocarcinoma cells in the bone. He was a strapping man, and apart from a little bit of pain in the humerus, he had no other complaint. He was worked up. This was in the early days. No primary was found. He received chemo, but the patient literally withered away and died within a year and a half. Okay, what about the caveat for axillary nodes? There's something to remember here. If you have an axillary or supraclavicular node in a woman, 98% of the time the primary is in the breast. You don't need to do a very, very drastic workup. First workup for a breast before you work up for anything else. Most often you will have breast marker like GATA3 positive, ERPR positive or negative maybe. These patients do well with treatment as if they are for a breast cancer. What you do when you have tumors which borrow features of squamous and glandular, I don't know what to call this. This is the same sort of matter which I've given earlier. You need to look, when you see something very undifferentiated, look at the level of the node before you decide what it could be. Lower levels, thyroid, pancreas, GI tract, higher levels, thyroid or salivary gland or even adnexal tumors. This is that famous chart of CK7, CK20. I've taken this from a very, very good YouTube presentation of a Dr. Abrari, who talked about the role of immuno in deciphering cups. It's worth seeing. It's on the YouTube. And this, I think this chart, everybody does know. At some point or the other, we all refer to it. Now, adenocarcinoma, whether it's from the ovary, prostate, lung, they look alike. They don't look very different from each other. Subtle features, yes, you will learn. But more often than not, you will require CK7 or CK20 to help you to pinpoint what could be the possible primary. Are there cups with a papillary architecture? In my experience, very few. The few we've seen are thyroid or salivary gland. We've also seen a couple from breast, but they are not so common. Again, the same chart to tell you, look at the level of the node before you decide where you're going to search and what immunos you're going to do. Okay, let's go to supraclavicular node from a 53-year-old one. Delicate, fragile cells seen in this cluster. There's a bit of molding of the cells, loose clusters. Morphologically, these are very fragile cells. When you see small cell tumor in the head and neck or anywhere else, think of a small cell carcinoma, neuroendocrine tumors, including medullary carcinoma or Merkel cell carcinomas. They are so delicate that when you do an FNAC, if you do it roughly, you get all this streaking and of the cells. The cytoplasm gets pulled out and the cells, they get pulled out, but you can still see the molding and the chromatin pattern, which is fine and like salt and pepper. So the biopsy, this is a classical case of small cell carcinoma with the necrosis. You can see the cytology is much better. Immuno will show you chromogranin or synaptophysin or both. Primary could be in the head and neck or even in the lung. This is from Dr. Shidham's book, who describes the cells. Small cells, scanty amount of cytoplasm. The chromatin of the cell is salty or peppery. That's how you get the word salt and pepper. You may get more salt or more pepper to give you the different patterns of small cell carcinoma cells. They are fragile cells. Their nuclear details of chromatin are the salt and pepper. They don't have a nice prominent nucleoli most often. They tend to be fragile and to smear. They can be molding, get a lot of individual cell debris and necrosis. They don't have a desmoplastic stroma to hold them. And there's subtle mitosis. Okay. Now, what about polydifferentiated and undifferentiated tumors? All of these could look similar. They could be of different lineages, squamous, glandular, from lung, breast, or melanoma. Obviously, it's your immuno which is going to help you. This is the recent most case which is on my table. It was a needle core biopsy, very, very undifferentiated looking, high grade anaplastic looking cells. We couldn't really find the primary, but we finally pinned it down to something in the liver, maybe a cholangiocarcinoma. So the question may be asked, why do you want to do so many immunos? You do immunos because sometimes you need to confirm that it is malignant. For example, I showed you that branchial cleft cyst. You need to confirm, yes, is it a carcinoma or it's something mimicking a carcinoma? Is it a sarcoma or is it some melanoma? That's why you do immunos. You do immunos to help this 20% of patients who have favorable CUPS who will respond and go after the hormone-sensitive tumors. If you suspect this patient has a sensitive or a favorable CUP, it's better to do more than to do less. Go after those cancers where targeted treatment, not treatment, is available, as for lung or colorectal. So this is just something. When CUP, especially for undifferentiated, poor differentiated, we are groping in the dark. Again, I have taken recourse to Dr. Abrari's presentation. Undifferentiated carcinomas, you may have to do a panel of them depending on the clinical presentation. For cancers, you may do CK720, EMA, P16 for if you're HPV, if you're thinking of nasopharyngeal, for squamous carcinomas. The panels are very clearly spelled out in all textbooks. This is one panel you need to remember because this is a potentially curable cancer. So time to get out, use your history, radiology, your IHC judiciously if you want to get out of the CUP. This case, this was an FNAC of a level 4 neck node. Now, when I showed this to my student, many of them said rhabdo. Okay, this is normal muscle. The tumor is all these cells, cells with prominent nucleoli and fairly discrete. You see this face quite often. Sometimes you're wondering, are you looking at a cancer, carcinoma? Are you looking at a lymphoma? Or, as in this case, are you missing something? This is a melanoma. So if you look hard, whether you see a duck or a rabbit, it depends on how well you've searched the slides for clues. So melanoma is a great mimic. You can have something in the eyeball, scalp, head and neck region with metastasis to neck nodes. Occasionally, they present as CUP lesions because the primary regresses or it disappeared. Your markers, S100 and HMB45, would help. Now, most of our Indians will know what I'm talking about. Here is a very potentially curable CUP story. Young males, often a midline lesion, or in this case, a supraclavicular lesion, needle core biopsy done, describing a poorly differentiated carcinoma. You have a male, young male, midline lesion, anywhere along the midline, even mediastinum. Think of a cancer of the extragonadal type, which is a germ cell tumor. These are curable. The patients do very well. Maybe they'll even give a history of undescended testes or of an orchidectomy done in the past. This patient of ours had a history of orchidectomy, and for some reason, the surgeon had thrown away the specimen. So they never had a diagnosis of the primary, and we got this in the supraclavicular node. So you know who I'm talking about. What about serum tumor markers? Routine evaluation has not proved to be of great value. But when you're doing specific areas, for example, for prostate, PSA is important in bone metastasizing adenocarcinomas. Beta-HCG alpha-fetoproteins in patients with undifferentiated tumors, CA125, though it's not very specific markers, but when you see a high rising titer, you may think of an ovarian primary, CA15.3, they're supposedly for women with adenocarcinomas. Okay, let's go to the strengths and the weaknesses of IHC. IHC has great strength, yes, but its weakness is that it's not faithful. Like this fellow getting married and still having a girlfriend, IHC is not always faithful to one antigen. They are promiscuous. And there is a story of cross-reactivity of one or many. Here you have one antigen antibody with many antigens. So IHC is dependent on many things, technical expertise, factors like fixation time, cold ischemic time, the clone of antibody used. Your interpretation also needs to be guided by looking at the proper area. Is it a nuclear stain, cytoplasmic, or a cytoplasmic border stain? In spite of all these weaknesses, IHC is still useful when you think about it and when you use it judiciously. In more than half of the case, IHC is helpful. It forces you to think logically. Dr. Abrari gave this very frightening table that if I frightened you with such lids, CK is positive in so many lesions. Obviously, you won't think of all of them. You will think of it appropriate to the clinical picture, the age, the location of the tumor. But this is just to show you the, what shall I say, the promiscuity of IHC. IHC, the types are increasing every day. You have so much IHC to deal with every day. You have lists of cases of IHCs which are old and new. You've got to keep up, but it doesn't mean you have to do everything. You'll probably have to use your judgment, read the literature before you decide whether you're going to do a lot or a little. It's just to lighten the mood. IHC costs. The patient has to pay a huge bill. When lymphomas come along, they pay huge bills, but sometimes more than the cost of the biopsy. And here is a patient who is dying much before the list is over. So the result of doing too many IHCs, maybe you get the answer, but the patient has to pay for it. And when you do too little, or you have not understood, you just give an undifferentiated tumor, your patient may not benefit, he may die before you arrived at it, and you've lost the faith of your clinician. I don't believe this pathologist at all. He's not doing enough IHC. So will IHC help? Yes, it will help separate histogenic type. It'll tell you what is carcinoma. It'll tell you what's a lymphoma, a melanoma, neuroendocrine. It will help you in searching for the primary, may prognosticate, but it'll be only useful if you use it with a little bit of logic and judiciously. When tumor cells look totally faceless, and even IHC fails, molecular arrays are done. I have no experience, personal experience of it, but I suspect it would be very useful in patients who have possible favorable cancers, and you need to chase these tumors. Now, in spite of everything, there will be some 5 to 8 or even 10% of cases which will remain undifferentiated right till the end. So this is a nice table I found on the net by Mary Ondini. It shows the evolution of the clinical pickup of CUP. How did the clinical evaluation go on from rudimentary to now being extensive? The pathology from just HNE and FNSE to IHC and molecular diagnostic. Favorable setups, subsets were detected later in years. Treatment protocols are now site-specific and prognosis has improved over the years. So to finally wind up, yes, it's a rare cancer, but it has a high death rate. And pathologists, the onus of diagnosis will fall on the pathologist. CUP carries a different natural history compared to those tumors where you know the primary. Clinically and histologically, CUP is not one disease. It is so many diseases. It is a carcinoma, or it's a sarcoma, or you name it, you have a variety of diseases. Your IHC is your lodestone. It is your cornerstone for diagnosis. Don't underestimate it, even though it can have a lot of cross-reactivity. Molecular analysis have proved to be very sensitive in detecting the primary, and you have radiological methods. Don't spend too much excessive time and your patient's money if you have a very advanced, unfavorable CUP. You know that patient has liver mets, lung mets. He's sick. He's probably dying. No point in increasing his bills too much. Try to identify the favorable types, be judicious, definitely talk to your radiologist and the treating physician when in doubt, and don't get intimidated by the unfaithful cross-reactivity of IHC. Resort to lateral thinking. What looks like a toad might finally look like a horse after you've done your investigations. Thank you for being very patient and listening to me. I come from Prince Ali Khan Hospital. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chinoy. That was wonderful. Excellent presentation. It was really very, very nice. Thank you. That I think cleared all the doubts that I had been trying to clear. So thank you so much. We have a few questions. First, I will make an announcement. Anyone else on YouTube, please put up your questions. Right now, we have two from Mondal sir. The first one is, how one can solve the problem of primary squamous cell carcinoma of parenchyma cyst with metastatic squamous cell carcinoma in lymph node?
Okay. Dr. Mondal, are you there?
He will hear you, but he can't really respond.
Okay. I had one case where I called a branchial cyst as a malignant carcinoma arising in the branchial cyst. Okay. And I presented it to one of the experts in one of the meetings, and he said, no, this entity doesn't exist. So a branchial cyst doesn't become squamous carcinoma. I personally had diagnosed it as that, but I was told that this entity is not a correct diagnosis. It's just squamous carcinoma arising. Now, what is the second part of the question?
Second part was how with the branchial cyst with metastatic squamous cell carcinoma in lymph node. Basically, a primary squamous cell carcinoma of branchial cyst with metastatic squamous cell carcinoma in the lymph node.
So that's what the answer to that was, that a branchial cyst is an entity which is benign. It doesn't usually become, or it has not been known to definitely become a carcinoma.
Thank you. There is his second question. Have you come across case of primary squamous cell carcinoma of thyroid with metastatic lesion in the lymph node as unknown primary in the lymph node?
No, I have not. But I do see squamous carcinoma in thyroid cancers. I mean, not pure, but we see metaplastic squamoid cell change in thyroid cancers. And the node can mimic the primary. But usually you have a clue about it. You have some other, like a follicular or a papillary differentiation. But I've never seen a pure squamous carcinoma of the thyroid. I believe it does exist.
Okay. And then how to solve the problem of metastatic biphasic synovial sarcoma in cervical lymph node?
The problem of metastatic.
Yeah. Metastatic biphasic synovial sarcoma in cervical lymph node.
So what's the problem?
I'm also wondering, I mean, if the diagnosis is there.
Yeah, then it's synovial sarcoma.
Yes, I guess so. Okay, then Dr. Priya has a question for you. Which is more preferable, FNAC or core biopsy?
Definitely. Pathologists prefer more. So I'm not saying that FNAC is my first choice. FNAC is a guide. You have an abscess and then you can abort the procedure. Or you've diagnosed cancer, but it's sarcomatoid, then you need a core biopsy. So it's your first stepping stone. Maybe you've got the answer in a keratinizing squamous, that's fine. But very often you need it followed up with a core biopsy. So I would prefer both. So what my radiologist does, he does a core biopsy. And the last part, what is in his needle, he washes it with saline and makes smears. He knows I like cytology. So he does both for me. on the quest.
That's nice. Okay, another one from Mondal sir. Does PET scan help in locating the primary site?
Yes, it does. And this has been true or proven mainly in breast. MRI and PET scan. They found tiny breast. I've seen this and big axillary mass or supraclavicular mass. And a PET and MRI. MRI particularly has homed down and found a primary in the breast.
That's interesting. Then there is yeah, Dr. Priya again. Any role of microRNA expression in cups?
I told you I have no experience of it primarily, but it's proved, or the literature says it's extremely good. It has a good sensitivity and specificity. So I'm sure people who have the facility should do it.
Okay, Dr. Divya is asking, what is the panel for a sarcoma? Oh, that'll be large.
I think Dr. Mondal must have taken this.
Yes.
Right? So you. Your primary panel, you do a muscle marker, or maybe Desmond Mayo. You do a CD34. You do a S100 if you want to think of a nerve sheath tumor. And depending on what you're looking at, is it a round cell, a spindle cell? You can do a marker like MIC2, what is that? 99, CD99. So our primary panel will depend. Well, these are the usual four markers, but it will depend on your age, the location, what is the clinical picture, what is the cytology. I don't think I can give the whole algorithm.
Yes, I was just saying that will be large. It's quite a large one. Then there is Dr. Mondal saying, does that I asked you? Okay. And yes, and Dr. Mondal has also said that he has published one case of primary squamous cell carcinoma of branchial cyst. So I think you can share it with us at some point. Yes, and then there is biphasial synovial sarcoma. One component may be metastatic that creates a problem.
Yeah, in my experience, if a tumor, any tumor, even a sarcoma has a epithelioid component, it does go to nodes. So I have found that the one going to the nodes is often the one which has the epithelial component. Of course, a synovial sarcoma can have your glandular and your spindle cell component, and maybe the poorly differentiated will get go to the node. If you see a tumor which is cellular, pretty monotonous, no desmoplasia, a characteristic vascular pattern, think of synovial. And if you've got the primary, then link it up that it's Mets. So it will be a talk on soft tissue tumors.
Actually, that's his own talk. We'll have to tell him to take another one. Okay. So, and other, of course, besides questions, there have been also a lot of comments of everyone saying that it has been very great listening to you and very informative. And today, I think for the first time, we have gone well beyond our regular neighborhood of countries where we have people attending. We have Dr. Osmani, who is attending all the way from Ecuador. So he is in an entirely different time zone. And I think that takes a lot of effort to attend. So it's nice to have him here. But we have everybody saying, wonderful talk, ma'am. And it truly was wonderful. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
And if there are no questions, Dr. Bhavna, and any more questions left anywhere?
Thank you very much, Vandana.
Thank you, ma'am.
All
This
done.
was really wonderful. Okay, I think Bhavna is about to tell us that there is one more question.
Ma'am, Nandini ma'am has posted, ma'am, how often do we see oral metastatics from other organs and madam's experience in that?
I do see a lot in the supraclavicular node. In the level 5, we see a lot of them coming from GI tract, from lung, in males. And from even I've seen cervix and ovary coming. So yes, we see a lot. And a lot of them are referred from different parts of the country. In our particular hospital, the main emphasis being a head and neck cancer institute, we see a lot of squamous. But supraclavicular is a favored site for cancers spreading from below the clavicle. I mean, from lung or breast or, yes, in my experience, I've seen a lot.
Today, we also have Dr. Prakash Patil. I'm very happy. I mean, he is my teacher and he has been my mentor and he's actually attending one of the cases. So I'm rather happy.
Hi, Prakash. How are you?
Oh, yes. Then, of course, everyone is just saying very great session. And even Dr. Prakash Patil has said very interesting talk. Thanks to Dr. Chinoy. And Asitwa Mondal sir also says excellent. So I think we had a very informative lecture. Dr. Priya also says very informative lecture for oral pathologists, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's very
Thank you so much. It was really wonderful having you here, Dr. Chinoy, and it has been really great fun. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. To everybody. Thank you.
We hope to see you again back soon with some more cases and another presentation. When you have recovered from doing this one, then I think another one will be nice.
Go and see Dr. Abrari's presentation on the same subject. Really good.
We'll do that. And I'll try and locate the link and put it in the description so everyone else can also find it.
I put the link in. It's in YouTube.
Okay. Yes. That's great. That will be very, very helpful. Yes.
Okay. Thank you all.
Ma'am, there is one more question.
Okay. They're not going to let you go, ma'am. Yes.
What is the ratio between the CCR5 and the origin of metastasis, ma'am?
Anyone in the audience know what is CCR5?
And related to HIV virus, ma'am. It's a macrophage tropic strain for human immunodeficiency virus type 1 and type 2, ma'am. HIV pathogenesis, it plays a role in HIV pathogenesis.
HIV pathogenesis. No.
Okay, I have a few cases who are HIV positive or immunocompromised with meds, but I don't think it's a very high percentage.
I also have one last person who just said, thank you for the informative lecture. That's Dr. Devendra Palve. So I think we will just call it a day. Thank you, ma'am. Have a wonderful day and thank you for being here with us. So thank you everyone for being here. I definitely hope you will join us again next week. Have a great day. Have a great week and see you again soon.